Hello everyone. Today we will discuss about the pharmacological aspects of general anesthetics. The key points which will be covered in the present topic are definition, characteristic features of general anesthetics, stages of anesthesia, recent advancement techniques, classification of general anesthetics, mechanism of action and pre-anesthetic medication. This is the pictorial representation of the agony endured in operations before the advent of anesthesia. When there were no anesthetic agents, people had to suffer a lot of pain even from the small incision to the major surgical procedures. But with the advention of general anesthetics, these procedures become quite acceptable. General anesthetic, basically the anesthesia word comes from the combination of two words, and aesthesis. And means without, and aesthesis means sensation. Anesthetic is the agent that brings about the reversible loss of consciousness with the loss of sensation as well. The general anesthetics are administered by anesthesiologist in order to induce or to maintain the anesthesia to facilitate the surgical procedures. The major characteristic features of general anesthesia are three, and these are analgesia, amnesia, and followed by unconsciousness. Analgesia is the sensation of loss of pain. Amnesia is loss of memory for short term, and followed by the unconsciousness state. And if we talk about the stages of general anesthesia, there are four stages. Stage one is of analgesia, in which the loss of pain sensation takes place along with the disorientation and altered consciousness. Stage two is delirium stage, which comprises of the excitatory stage, and in uncontrolled body movements takes place along with the irregular breathing. Stage 3 is the actual stage under which the surgical procedures are done. Attaining this stage, the irregular breathing now returns to the regular respiration with light anesthesia to deep anesthesia. Surgical procedures are performed basically under this stage, and supported ventilation is required. Stage 4 is followed by stage 3. Sometimes, if we do not concentrate on the concentration of or the dose of anesthetic we use, basically this is the stage between the respiratory arrest and the death due to circulatory collapse. Bispectral index is basically a newer technology which purport to monitor the depth of anesthesia. It allows the anesthetist to adjust the amount of anesthesia to need of the patient. This base index ranges from 100 to 0. 100 is the full awakening stage in which the patient responds to normal voice of surgeon. The 60 to 40 range is basically coincide with the stage 3 of general anesthesia, in which major surgical procedures are carried out, and from 20 to 0, this is the stage which resembles, this index resembles the stage 4, in which death could occur due to respiratory collapse. Now we talk about the classification. Major two classes have been categorized into general anesthesia. One is inhalation anesthetic and second is intravenous anesthetic. Further, inhalation anesthetics are subdivided into two categories, gases and halogenated liquids. Under gases we have nitrous oxide, and under halogenated liquids we have halothane, isoflurane, sevoflurane and n-fluorine. Intravenous anesthetic agents comprise of inducers and maintenance drugs. Inducer agents are thiopentone and propofol, and slower acting agents, or we can call them as maintenance drug therapy, They are benzodiazepine derivatives like diazepam and lorazepam. Along with it, a member which causes dissociative anesthesia, that is ketamine. And to induce neuroleptic analgesia, we use intravenously fentanyl and droperidol. Now first we take up the inhalation anesthetics. Under gases, nitrous oxide, it is widely used, potent analgesic and produces a light anesthesia. So short term, small surgical procedures, we can use nitrous oxide. They do not depress the respiration and they are mainly used as adjunct therapy with other inhalations. Halothane, isoflurane and fluorine are halogenated liquids. Halothane is 20% metabolized by P450 enzyme and it is a good inducer of hepatic microsomal system. The major side effect associated with halothane is myocardial depression and it leads ultimately to arrhythmia. Isoflurane is the most widely employed member of this category, which causes smooth and rapid induction as well as recovery. Very less amount of isoflurane is get metabolized in the body and it also does not possess any kind of hepatotoxicity or renotoxicity. Means this is the safest drug under this category, that is why it has been widely employed. Anfluorine is basically used to replace the halothane. If patient is not responding to halothane, it can be he can be switched over to anfluorine. It is also rapid smooth induction and maintenance drug category agent. Now intravenous induction agents, they are thiopentone sodium, ketamine and propofol. Thiopentane is rapid onset of action of around 20 seconds. Also, it has short duration of action of around 10 minutes. Thiopentane sodium effect gets eliminated in the body by redistribution and not by metabolism. Ketamine is, on the other hand, NMDA receptor antagonist. It's a glutamate type of receptor and it usually stimulates the circulatory system. It is analgesic as well as dissociative anesthetic agent. Propofol is short acting agent and used for induction of general anesthesia. Sometimes it can be used in the maintenance drug therapy of general anesthesia. The onset of action of propofol is 1 minute after the injection. Now if we talk about the mechanism of action of the drugs, all these drugs are protein receptor interacting agents. They show excellent protein receptor interaction to major three type of receptors: GABA-A receptor, NMDA receptor and glycine receptors. Inhalation anesthetics, they majorly potentiate the GABA-A receptors, that means they potentiate the opening of fluoride ion channels and thereby causing the anesthetic effect. Similarly, glycine receptor potentiation is done with halogenated liquids and NMDA receptor inhibition occurs through ketamine and nitrous oxide agent. This is how they act on the receptor and produce the desired effect. There is one important term used in general anesthetics is minimum alveolar concentration. This is the golden point to be discussed here. Basically, it measures the potency of inhaled anesthetics. Minimum alveolar concentration is the lowest concentration of general anesthetic in alveoli, which is needed to produce the immobility in response to painful stimulus. There are some conditions based on which we can choose a general anesthetic agent. If we want the faster onset of action and to avoid the time spent in phase 2 of general anesthesia, means to avoid the excitatory phase of anesthesia, we can opt for intravenous anesthetics. For inhalational therapy, generally it is employed where intravenous access is difficult, when there is anticipation difficulty in intubation, and if the patients are children. Now, The pre-anesthetic medications, they are used before the employment of general anesthesia. The main aim of the pre-anesthetic medications are to produce amnesia pre- and post-operative events. Supplements analgesic effect and potentiate them so that the dosage required to produce the anesthetic effect will be less. Decreases the secretion and vagal tone so that during the surgical procedure there should not be any kind of hindrance because of these excess secretions. Anti-emetic effect, which is to be shown usually post anesthetic timings, and decrease in the acidity. But the first and foremost aim of the pre-anesthetic medication is the relief of anxiety. The patient should not be too anxious before any kind of surgical procedure. If we talk about opioids, morphine and pethidine are the agents, but they are restricted only when the patient is having preoperative pain, because the major disadvantage of using opioids as a pre-anesthetic agent is they causes the steep fall in blood pressure during the surgery time. Anti-anxiety agents include the benzodiazepine as well as the barbiturate agents, and they are mainly used to calm the patient. Anticholinergics, they decreases the secretions. Neuroleptic agents, they use with caution in children because of involuntary muscle movement and dystonia. H2 blocker, ranitidine, famotidine and proton pump inhibitors, omeprazole, are basically used for controlling the acid content in the body, and they are routinely used before prolonged surgeries. And last but not the least, the anti-emetic agents, metoclopramide, domperidone and ondansetron, they are highly effective in reducing the incidence of post-anesthetic nausea and vomiting. So this is all we have discussed about the major pharmacology of general anesthetics. Thank you for your patience listening.